I'd like to begin with a quote from one of my favorite books by A.W. Tozier, The Knowledge of the Holy. He writes, "The greatest need of the present hour is that lighthearted, superficial religiosity be struck down with a vision of God high and lifted up, with the train of his robe filling the temple." Let me repeat that. The greatest need of the present hour is that lighthearted, superficial religiosity be struck down with a vision of God high and lifted up. There may be no statement in all the writings of Tozier with which I agree more. In fact, there are few statements in the English language that I could affirm more wholeheartedly. Even though Tozier wrote these words more than 50 years ago, when Harold John Ockingay was the pastor of this church and Dwight Eisenhower was the president of this country, those words are as true today as when he first penned them, because American evangelical religion is more lighthearted and superficial than ever. Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1. "In the year King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on a throne, high and exalted." In the year King Uzziah died. Now, you might be tempted when hearing the text read to skip over that first line, to regard it as a mere reference to time. But that would be a mistake, because this phrase is full of meaning. It would be like saying to my grandparents, "In the year the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor," or to their parents, "In the year the stock market crashed," or like saying to many of us, "In the year John F. Kennedy died," or "the year the Twin Towers fell." You see, this phrase meant something to the people in Isaiah's day, because the death of Uzziah was a turning point in their history and in their lives. In 20 short years, the nation of Assyria would come sweeping into Palestine and almost annihilate the northern 10 tribes of Israel and create a climate of fear in Jerusalem, the center of the southern two tribes where Uzziah reigned, that would never quite go away. But as long as King Uzziah sat on the throne, and he sat on the throne a long time, the people of Judah felt safe and secure, because he was a good king and a strong king. And under his leadership, they were experiencing a period of peace and prosperity like they had not seen since the days of Solomon the Great, some 140 years before. But now, King Uzziah is dead, and the ground underneath them is beginning to shake. And some of them can hear the sound of approaching hoofbeats, the sound of war coming, and with it, the sound of a coming economic crisis, the sound of the world as they know it, perhaps coming to an end. And so Isaiah did what religious people do when they feel like their world may be falling apart. He went into the temple to pray. I don't know, maybe he was hoping to find an island of peace in the midst of the storm, or to find assurance that everything in the end would be all right, that someone just as strong and just as good would rise up to take Uzziah's place. But if so, Isaiah was in for a surprise, because someone not as strong and not as good rose up to take Uzziah's place and the place of his son. "But in the year King Uzziah died, Isaiah saw the Lord." He saw the Lord seated on a throne, high and lifted up, so high and lifted up that all Isaiah really saw was the hem of his robe cascading down and filling the temple. And then he saw the seraphim, those fiery angelic creatures all around the throne, and each one had six wings. And with two wings, they covered their eyes, daring not to look on the face of God. And with two wings, they covered their feet, not daring to touch down in the presence of God. And with the other two wings, they continually flew. And as they flew, they cried out to one another, "Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." And then there was this thunderous refrain, the whole earth is full of His glory, of His glory. And at the sound of their voices, the temple actually began to shake. This was no distant thunder of approaching hoofbeats. No, this was more like the time as a young boy when I was camping with my family in the wilderness of Arizona, and we were in a trailer, and I had been put to bed, and I was just going off to sleep when, boom, lightning struck 50 feet from our trailer, and I shot up out of the bed as I felt the whole trailer shaking. Have you ever been in the midst of an earthquake? You see, Isaiah was in the middle of an earthquake, and the doorpost and the threshold were quaking with fear, and the building, a building like this, it was feeling like it was about to fall down around him. And then suddenly the room begins to fill with smoke like it was on fire. But this smoke is not like any smoke that Isaiah had ever seen before. Oh, he had heard about this fiery smoke. Isaiah had heard about the fiery cloud of God's glory that had come down on Mount Sinai when the people of Israel heard God's voice speak the Ten Commandments. And Isaiah had heard about that fiery cloud that filled the temple the day that Solomon dedicated it, a cloud so awesome and amazing that the priests were not even able to enter. But those were just stories long ago and far away. This was happening to him right now. And quite frankly, it was more than Isaiah could take. So let me ask you a question. What do you expect it will be like when you finally meet the resurrected Jesus Christ and God the Father on His throne in glory someday? What feelings do you think you will feel? What will you be thinking? Will you be happy? Will you be experiencing peace like a river? Will you burst forth in song, "Oh, the joy that floods my soul"? Well, let me say that eventually, ultimately, I believe that will be our experience. That and more than we can even imagine. But I dare say, our first encounter with the living God in all His glory will be a bit more unnerving than that. I mean, think about what happened to the Apostle John when he saw the resurrected Jesus, with his face shining like the sun, his feet glowing like molten bronze, his voice resounding with the sound of a multitude of waterfalls. I mean, John fell at his feet as though dead. I mean, the very life was sucked out of him, and he was sore afraid, to use a little bit of old English. I mean, he was so afraid that Jesus had to reach out and place his right hand upon him and say, "Do not be afraid." And remember, this was John, the apostle. This was a man who had walked and talked with Jesus on this earth. This was the man that was so close to Jesus at the Last Supper that he could lean back upon his breast. I mean, John had been one of Jesus' dearest friends. And here he was on the Isle of Patmos, exiled because of his faithfulness to Jesus. I mean, if there was ever a man who could stand with confidence and great joy in the presence of the resurrected Jesus, John was that man. But that's not what John did. No, he fell down like a man who was undone, just like Isaiah. And why? Why? Because God the Father, God the Son, and God the Spirit is holy, holy, holy. So what does that mean? I mean, what does it mean that God is holy? Do you understand? I mean, not just here in your head, but down here in your heart. Because it turns out that holiness is a rather difficult word to fully define. I mean, its root meaning is not so difficult. It means separate or distinct. That which is holy is separate. It's set apart and distinct from that which is not holy. But what does that mean? I mean, separate and distinct in what sense? Well, I would suggest in at least two senses. And the first sense is separate and distinct like this. See, that which is holy is high and lifted up. It is exalted. And in the case of God, the Holy One is so exalted, so high and lifted up, that you can look up and up and up and up, and all you will ever see is the hem of his robe or the bottom of his foot. I mean, what Isaiah is experiencing in this moment is the thrice holy King of all creation, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, touching down for a moment on his footstool, the temple on planet Earth. And the holiness of God refers first and foremost to God's absolute exaltation above everyone and everything in all times and in all places. And when someone like you or me finds himself in the presence of such exalted holiness, we feel small. Small in being. Humbled. Dependent. Painfully vulnerable. As heavy as a feather in a whirlwind. As big as a grain of sand in the expanse of God's universe. I mean, have you ever felt just a little bit like that? I mean, have you ever gone outside on a starry, starry night and looked up and in the words of the psalmist found yourself saying, "What is man that you would be mindful of him? The Son of Man, that you, the Holy One, would take thought of him?" But there's more. There is more to the holiness of God than his infinite exaltation above everyone and everything that is. Because holiness is also a word with moral overtones. In fact, more than anything else, the holiness of God refers in Scripture to God's blazing moral purity. God is light, the Apostle John declares, and in him there is no darkness at all. There's not the slightest shadow of impurity or imperfection. Nothing unrighteous. In fact, God is the very definition of what is good and right. And God's holiness is his moral perfection. His goodness, beauty, and truth in all of its blazing brilliance. And hence its constant association with the word glory, the shining forth of that brilliance. And when ordinary sinful human beings come into the presence of such beautiful and blinding moral purity, it is deeply, deeply unsettling. It fills us with a strange, almost contradictory sense of fascination and fear. It simultaneously draws us and drives us away. Because the moral perfection of God is captivatingly beautiful beyond description. But the experience of that blazing moral purity up close can be dreadful. It's like walking toward a blazing fire. Or better yet, since we're speaking of God, it's like walking into that ball of fire we call the sun. At a distance, the sun is warm. And warming. It's full of light and it's life-giving. In the light of the sun, we experience everything that we call good and beautiful and true. But up close, that same sun can be life-threatening and blinding. And when Isaiah saw the Lord seated on a throne, when he caught just a glimpse of the God who dwells in light, unapproachable and full of glory, he was struck down with his own sense of utter sinfulness. "Woe is me," he cried. "Woe is me. I am undone. I feel like I'm falling apart at the seams. Because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell among a people of unclean lips." And I'm sure you know that Isaiah wasn't just speaking of his lips. No, his lips represent what he says, and what he says comes from who he is down deep in his being, and in the presence of the blinding moral purity of God's holiness. Isaiah sees in a way that perhaps he has never seen before. How dark his heart really is. How dark all our hearts really are. And that is what holiness does. It shines the light of God's blazing moral purity into our hearts, and it reveals whatever darkness is there. And therefore, it knocks the wind out of us, like it did John. It strikes us to the ground like Isaiah moaning, "Woe is me." It strips away the sham and the pretense of all of our so-called good works, which Isaiah will later call filthy rags, and it makes us beat our chest like the tax collector of old and cry out, "Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner." And that, Tozer says, is what is missing in our world today. A sense of sin. And not just a sense of sin, but fear and trembling in the presence of a holy God because of our sin. And not just in the world out there, but here, in the church, and here, in my heart. In what Tozer calls our light-hearted, superficial religiosity. I mean, when was the last time that you or I wept or moaned over our sin? Or the sin of our brothers and sisters in Christ? I mean, where is the fear of God in the house of God? And how do we ever expect to restore a sense of sin in the world around us if it's missing in our own lives? Now, perhaps some of you are saying, wait a minute, Pastor. Wait a minute. Aren't we supposed to love God, not just fear Him? I mean, isn't God a God of love? And doesn't the Bible say in 1 John chapter 4, verse 18, that perfect love casts out fear? Well, the short answer is yes, He is, and yes, it does. God is a God of love. That was my whole point 3 weeks ago when I shared with you Jesus' parable of the love of the waiting father for his lost daughters and sons. And God's love for us, which evokes a loving response in us, does overcome our fears. Our fear of condemnation, our fear of rejection, our fear of ending up utterly alone in the darkness of this universe. But, first there must be a fear that is overcome. And I dare say, even after that fear is overcome by love, there is a kind of fear that remains. I mean, look at Isaiah. The story did not end with Isaiah moaning and groaning on the ground. No, a fiery seraph flies to the altar, picks up a burning coal with tongs, and touches that coal to Isaiah's unclean, tender lips. And then the angel says, "Your guilt is taken away. Your sin atoned for." I mean, this is a beautiful moment. This is an amazing moment, a moment of amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. And this moment is as much a part of Isaiah's encounter with a holy God as the earthquake and the fiery cloud and the seraphim's reverberating song. And Isaiah discovers in this moment that the holiness of God is the holiness of a God who loves. It's a loving holiness. It's a holy love, a love that burns with blazing moral purity, yes, and consumes all that which is not pure, yes, but also a love that finds a way to forgive and to restore and to redeem. And that way is the way of atoning sacrifice. In Isaiah's case, it's the sacrifice of a lamb on the temple altar. But we know that this call from the altar, which touched Isaiah's lips, was a sign and symbol of another sacrifice yet to come. The sacrifice of God's own Son, the Lamb of God who would be sent to take away the sins of the world, the eternal Son of the eternal God who would bear our sin in his body on the cross and who would rise victorious over sin and death and bring all who believe in him into the eternal presence of the triune God of holy love. That's the gospel. But would you please notice two things. Would you notice first that without repentance, there is no forgiveness of sins? Being struck down with a sense of sinfulness in the presence of God's holiness precedes the cleansing coal from the altar touching Isaiah's lips. But wherever you look in Scripture, you will see the same pattern. Conviction of sin and repentance for sin precedes the pronouncement of forgiveness of sin. It's only when the tax collector falls on his knees, beating his chest and crying out, "Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner," that he receives the forgiveness of God. And the Pharisee, for all his so-called righteousness, leaves the temple, Jesus says, unjustified, unforgiven by a holy God, because in his light-hearted, superficial religiosity, he never truly repented. I mean, you do realize, don't you, that without holiness, the gospel of Jesus Christ makes no sense. I mean, why did Jesus die on the cross? I mean, certainly he died because sinful men and women put him on that cross. They convicted him. They shouted, "Crucify him." They nailed him to the tree. But Jesus tells us he could have called legions of angels. So why didn't Jesus call those angels to rescue him? Why did Jesus offer himself willingly up to death on the cross? Well, he did it to offer himself as the Lamb of God to take away the sins of the world. He did it to bear in his body and in his being our sins on the cross, and on that cross to suffer the judgment of a holy God, and on that cross to take human sin into the very being of God, between Father and now human and divine Son, and to deal with our sin in that divine relationship so we would not have to bear it ourselves. And when we cry, "Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner," we acknowledge that it is our sin that put Jesus on that cross. My sin puts you, Jesus, on that cross. And we proclaim that we believe that only in the cross is my guilt taken away and my sin atoned for. It is the holiness of God that requires the cross, and it is the love of God that gives us the cross. Therefore, it is the holy love of God that saves us in and through the cross of Jesus Christ. And conviction of sin, A sense of fear and trembling in the presence of a holy God is the first step in our salvation, and it must precede forgiveness. But here's the second thing I want you to notice. I want you to notice that God does not become any less holy after Isaiah is forgiven. The blazing moral purity of God did not dim when that fiery seraph touched Isaiah's tender lips. I dare say that from that day forward, Isaiah trembled at the thought of ever sinning against such a holy and loving God again. Now, I imagine he did sin. In fact, I'm quite sure he sinned. But when he did, I imagine that he fell down in his heart and he cried, "Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner." You see, being forgiven by the love of a holy God does not make a person more likely to sin again. It does not cause her to take God's grace for granted. What causes people to take God's grace for granted is thinking that salvation is as lighthearted and superficial as praying a little prayer to invite Jesus into your life, without ever coming to grips with the seriousness of our sin or the price that was paid to deliver us from our sin. I mean, I guess what I'm trying to say is that once you and I genuinely encounter the holy love of God, we never quite stop trembling. Trembling at what could have been and what would have been if Jesus hadn't assumed our humanity and died in our place. Trembling at what it cost our Holy Father in heaven and his beloved Son on this earth to forgive our sins. Trembling at the awesome majesty and glory of such a God of holy love who would forgive our sins in this way. And trembling at the thought of ever displeasing our God of holy love again. I mean, let's go back to the question I asked a moment ago and expand it just a bit. When was the last time when you and I were struck down by a vision of our holy God and his resurrected Jesus Christ, high and lifted up? But when was the last time we wept and groaned inwardly for our sin? And therefore, when was the last time we were overwhelmed by his amazing, amazing grace? The greatest need of the present hour is that light-hearted, superficial religiosity would be struck down with a vision of God, high and lifted up. High and lifted up in heaven as the fiery seraphim cry, "Holy, holy, holy." High and lifted up on the cross of Jesus Christ as the Son prays, "Father, forgive them. They know not what they do." High and lifted up as we fall to our knees, beating our chest, and say, "Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner." Let's pray. Oh, Father, we cannot see or experience your majestic holiness without your revealing presence. It is only through your Son, Jesus Christ, and by the empowering presence of your Holy Spirit that we can see and understand, catch a glimpse of who you are and what the cross of Christ has cost. And it is only by your Holy Spirit in the mirror of the cross of Jesus Christ that we can begin to understand who we are and the sin that is in our souls. But I pray, Father, that in your mercy, you would enable us to see. And that as we gather at the table of your Son, that you would bring us to a place of deep repentance, so that we might receive overwhelming forgiveness. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.